The piece Two Sisters is a typical example of the music McLaughlin and Shankar play together. Its starting point is an Indian classical theme, a raga. But in Two Sisters, the raga theme is transformed by being played over a pattern of jazz chords. Each time the chord changes, so does the sound of the raga. For his experiments with Shankar, McLaughlin has designed a unique guitar. A standard guitar is unsuitable for playing Indian music. On the violin, for instance, it's possible to play microtones, which are infinitely subtle variations on the notes of a scale, a vital element in Indian music. But on an ordinary guitar, it's not possible to play the full range of microtones.
Now, the reason I had my guitar fingerboard modified is to facilitate this, in fact, because one can do it on the guitar. You hear blues guitars do it all the time. Bend a note like this. What my fingerboard does is to ease this enormously. Since the wood has been cut away, the pressure normally between a guitar and on a guitar fingerboard is friction between the fingertip and the fingerboard. Since the fingerboard is cut away, I have the possibility to really
And those extra strings, what do they do?
Since Shankar and I started to play in 1973, we were playing with just two drums and a drum. And so I thought about the possibility of using what has been existing in India for thousands of years, and that is what they call sympathetic strings. And so, for example, I played that. It sets up a harmonic background for me. I can accompany this very easily. And I can use what Shankar calls gamakas, or the bend, which is the blues, basic fundamental blues guitar.
Both McLaughlin and Shankar were established musicians before they met. Shankar is the son of India's leading violinist, He played his first concert when he was 7, and he's made more than 20 records in India. McLaughlin has played with some of the best jazz musicians in the world. During the early 70s, he broke through to a popular audience with his group, the Mahavishnu Orchestra. But with his explorations into Indian music, he was accused of leaving this popular audience behind.
For example, record companies and the promoters, they're not crazy about the idea. They think it's too esoteric, but that's their problem. They don't think how I think. They don't have my needs and desires to develop music. And the only way that I know how, and that is just to follow my own intuition. Because I find I've experienced being thinking that this is it, and it's not. Of course, you know, I think that if you have complete spiritual development, you can just sit in a cave in the Himalayas and travel throughout the universe, but that's another story. That's not my fate in this life. At least not up until this moment. I am a musician, and so since I have this, I have to deal with it in the best way I can.
John McLaughlin's musical journey started in the early 50s when he was 11. He inherited his first guitar from an older brother and heard his first records of the Mississippi Blues.
There was something about its feeling and its spontaneity, its movement, that was both magical and sensual. I know when I could put a record on the gramophone and play along with Muddy or play along with Big Bill and pick up little things like that. In fact, that was, the gramophone has been one of my great teachers throughout my life. Approximately the same time, I was about 13 or 14, I heard Django Reinhardt. He was a radical on the guitar. He revolutionized the concept of playing guitar because he had brilliant technique, great emotion, but with this wonderful elegance. About 15, I was exposed to Miles Davis music, which was another revelation for me. And it was a record called Milestones with John Coltrane, who was later to prove so influential on music and my life.
By his mid-teens, John McLaughlin had become a professional musician, borrowing his style from records of the best Americans. The trumpeter Miles Davis and saxophonist John Coltrane were the most influential. They could take a familiar show song and expand it musically, enriching the chord pattern with more complex harmonies and stretching and bending the rhythm. These were lessons in improvisation McLaughlin has never forgotten.
Started to play at the Flamingo Club with Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames. Now, at this point of time in England, it was a very fertile period, I think, since there were two clubs in London, the Marquee and the Flamingo, all-nighter club. And at the time, there were quite a lot of bands. There was John Mayall, Alexis Corner, Graham Bond's group, Dick Hexel-Smith, you know, and there was Eric Clapton. I remember the Rolling Stones coming into this club, the Flamingo Club, for an audition. And they played so out of tune, I said, what's happening to the world? You know, they were so bad, I couldn't believe it. I said, how can they even imagine that they'll get any work? But about 6 weeks later, they had a hit on the English charts, you know. I'd become a studio musician, insofar as that I'd been asked to go to do some studio dates, and I'd been asked back and asked back, and finally, for the first time in my life, I started to make some money, and that's, you know, and I was able to pay my debts, of which I had consistently. Oh, I can't even remember. Those very diverse things. Astro Gilberto, I used to do some TV shows. I used to play on Top of the Pops, which, I don't know if it's still running, maybe it's still running on English television. I was trying to, at the same time, maintain a musical direction. I had a definite idea about the music that I should be playing. Because this is the birthplace of the music that I particularly loved. And I arrived in early February 69. And the first night I arrive, Miles Davis is playing in Harlem. And the next day I went to Miles's house, and Miles asked me to come on his album, which was the most unexpected thing.
Bitches Brew and In a Silent Way, the records John McLaughlin made with Miles Davis, were the most influential of a new kind of music that emerged in the late 60s, jazz rock. For more than 50 years, popular music had been borrowing from jazz and blues. Now it was the turn of jazz musicians to borrow back from rock and roll. But when McLaughlin was offered a permanent place in the Miles Davis band, he turned it down.
I'd gone to the point of realizing in myself that there was another way that I wanted to go. And so I had to say no to Miles, which was a very peculiar situation to find myself in.
McLaughlin's Mahavishnu Orchestra of the early 1970s marked two big changes in his life. He broke through to the wider audience for rock music, and he became an active disciple of Indian religion. Most of the music of this period, popular though it was, he dedicated to his guru, an Indian named Sri Chinmoy. By this time, McLaughlin's music and his view of the world had become inseparable.
From Milestones, the album we spoke about, John Coltrane, I'd followed each individual's career, musically, and whatever information I could find out about them, to the point where John Coltrane released an album called A Love Supreme, which is one of the great records, I think, of the century. Now, in the beginning, I'd been listening to John Coltrane, I could hear him. But on this record, I couldn't hear what he was doing. I couldn't grasp what he was doing. However, there was a poem on the back, which is a great statement by he's a great and noble human being. And I knew that the music was talking about the same thing, only more so. But I couldn't hear it, I tried to grasp it, but here I had a connection between this, my sudden awakening to a desire to discover what is religion, or what is me, who am I, and suddenly I had a connection here between the music that I loved and India. The burning question that I had in me when the first time I saw Sri Chinmoy, I said to him, what is the relationship between spirituality and music? And the answer was very simple, sublimely simple, in fact. He said, if you become enlightened, if you become realized, then whatever you do will be imbued with the enlightenment of your consciousness. Of course, it's very simple now to see it, but, and of course it was simple then, but I couldn't see it. It was like I couldn't see the wood for the trees. Words get very clumsy at times like this because they're so inarticulate. What can I say?
Shankar's father has made the violin an accepted instrument in Indian classical music. He taught his son to improvise in the South Indian style, He encouraged Shankar to learn North Indian music and to listen to the European masters, especially Mozart, Beethoven, Stravinsky and Bartok. But it wasn't until he arrived in America that Shankar heard the improvised music of the West.
So I came here in 1969. Interestingly enough, like John came the same year from England, actually. And I came in 69 and I taught at the university, and also I was getting my PhD in ethnomusicology. And basically I was playing and all the time, and that was really nice for me for a change, because I didn't have to go to school just to study other things, you know. And that's where I really started listening a lot of other music, you know, like jazz. And I heard like Miles Davis and different people, John Coltrane. I had a great impact hearing that. Like, I had this friend who played trumpet, and we lived together, actually. And so he used to play me daily these records. That's when actually it's interesting, because he's the first one who mentioned to me about John. He said, you should listen to this guitar player who just came from England, no? And he put me the Miles Davis album, Bitches Brew, no? And he said, he's really incredible, you should listen to him. And then I played with him one day. I came to New York, and I was in his apartment, and we just played together. Then it was an all different thing. It's an all new thing started, because with other musicians, when I played, like before, like I had to play in their way. A lot of musicians I played with, it was more like I had to go all the time to their way, even on a free level, no? But with John, like, he can kind of go anywhere, no? And so he's one of the, at that point, he was the best musician that I ever worked with, no? Kind of, so I was really, when I played with him, I was very happy, and it was really incredible, because he was going, not only I was going in his way, like he was coming wherever I was going, and we had a fantastic rapport, right?
This final piece, Get Down and Shruti, is music in which the influences of jazz, blues, and India are so interwoven, it's impossible to hear the joins.
Thank you. Thank you.